everybody is ready to see what God wants to show in addition to the answer. I prayed, and I'm sure God is saying yes. But I can tell you, he didn't wait to see what God was trying to show him. And he said, I want to show you not just one thing, but things, even great things, even mighty things that you do not know. Can I remind you? You first called unto the Lord in prayer because of what you knew. You had an information. You had some knowledge of something that brought you to God in prayer. You knew something. So you ran to God for an answer. It's now saying that which you need that brought you to me in prayer is too infinitesimal compared to things you don't know. Because you don't know, you can't pray about them. You only pray about what you know. There are great and other things you cannot comprehend yet. And because you can't comprehend them, you will never make them your prayer points. They don't graduate to the point of becoming your prayer points because you couldn't touch them. These are things I want to do for you in addition to giving you the answer. I want to get married. Somebody said, because he or she is single. Fine, and I'm okay with that. But he forgets that after getting the answer as to who to marry or when to marry, there are many mysteries God wants to bring to him in addition to knowing who to marry or when to marry. Oh, he wants to get to another bosom and say, Lord, when you get there, we'll cross the bridge. Lord, I'm asking you again. But when he prayed that one prayer, there are many benefits waiting for him to see. It's my prayer that you will see, I will see, the great and many things God is always showing in addition to the answers he wanted, in Jesus' name. I want this, yes, the answer is guaranteed, but the bigger things, the moment you see what he's showing, don't forget, he says they are great, they are mighty things. You just one of them you see, put you above the answer you just got. The answer you just got is as little as the knowledge you have that moved you into prayers. If Joseph was privileged to see what God probably was going to show him, would he have desired to just go home from prison? Would he have just wanted to go home from prison? If he knew that in God's wisdom, he was the next prime minister of Egypt. The highest he could pray or trust God for was to get out of prison and go home. Do you agree with me? But because he didn't see what God was probably communicating to him, he could not have made his prayer point. That's why all you've prayed about shows how limited your knowledge is or was at the time of praying. And now you need to know or see many, many things he wants to show you. In addition to just your one-leg prayer, it also tells that your prayer is too loaded for the answer you're looking for. There's the guarantee that one prayer you pray in faith in the name of Jesus would not only bring the answer or answers, it will bring great and many things you never knew about. Say amen there. What do you want from God? Let God just say to me. I want X from God. Sadly, that's where she stops. At times, God delays the answer because he wants you to get to the point where you expect to see the great many things he wants to show you. Not because you are just stuck in just that prayer point. It delays and delays in his wisdom. Now you may know that when the answer shall have come to you, hey, you are still small. There are things to show so that you can now pray better. If your little child asked you for. Just one apple. I don't want to say biscuit. Apple. It is not good food. Mommy, I want apple. You'll be happy that she wants to eat apple. And now went and bought a carton of apples containing 96 apples. All for the child, made for your family. He doesn't know you have a carton, but because of one apple he asked for, or she asked for. The moment she sees that one apple, she's happy. When she sees the carton of apples he bought, the remaining has 5 apples, and other things he bought, plus Milo, plus Bobbita, plus Milk, I request to change. It's also my own. Give me this one too. Even the child knows that the answer to his prayer is still too small compared to the intention of the parent. If that's so with us as natural parents, what about God our Master? So I'm here to share with you on the things you don't know. The things that I don't know. This very scripture shows how ignorant we all are. And it is that decorated ignorance that moves us into all we do. And we still think we know so much. Even when there's an answer to our prayers, we pride ourselves in the answer we have got. In our testimonies, I pray to God and he answered me, help me, thank God, this God is good. But you should be crying for him. Because he never saw the great. And many things God was trying to show you. In addition to the answer, it's jubilating you. Somebody should be crying for because of his state of blindness. Because he's too much in the haste to have waited to see what God was trying to show him in addition to what he called his answer. How we need help today. As that's your prayer, as that X comes, the X comes with other things. Maybe you want a child, for instance. And that child comes and God begins to show you what the child will become. Isn't that awesome? You already know. This one, you're wasting your time. You can't take him away from this way he will be the judge because God showed you. John the Baptist, the answer came, they just said your prayer is answered. You have a son called John, he will be this, he will be that. That was not all the girls had prayed for. You have only asked for a child. He said, thy prayer, not thy prayers. Thy prayer is answered, is heard. You have that son, but you were too blind to have known that there are many more things that will become with you. It shall be this, it shall be that, it shall bring praise back to the children, and vice versa. You didn't know all that. So I have waited for all these years to see you pray the right prayer since you are too very gone. I have not come to take you, but now, in addition to you having a baby called John, these are the things that would happen by the child. This is what is supposed to be and what you will do. Those were great and married things in this chapter 1. That God was showing the Zechariah in a sort of long prayed and long answer prayer. Would you graduate this morning from just asking God for things to happen? And let X begin to come with generation things. I want a degree. And because the degree didn't know that there's an exemption. Only the answer when, in addition to the answer, he wants to show us great and many things which we don't know. Note that we call unto him mostly for what we know, to be a need. But he wants to show us what we do not know, so that we will no longer become needs, we will have answer you. There's no discussion about that. I will answer you. But he says, hey, don't get stuck on just getting the answer. I will show you stuff that will make you pretty much interpret it. First among equals. That's if you are equals, here you are. I will show you things that will distinguish the same again. That's what God is promising. Just in response to one prayer. So you see people waiting for years for just one answer. When they have to be hungrier for the things he wants to say. Now let's do it because I have many, many things to say. So many scriptures. Very true. Proverbs 7:1. And let's rush through all this. But by rush I mean, I don't want to describe anything. But just pay attention. The right and the right way. There's strong one in the street and just one. Just 7:1, Proverbs. Don't rashly announce what you are going to do tomorrow. What? You do not know. What don't you know? You don't know the trust thing about tomorrow. It tells you. Mind for behind you so arrogantly declare what you want to do tomorrow is by faith, yes. It's also by grace. But we don't know what tomorrow has to come. Talking of things we don't know. Somebody got something to me yesterday about Muslim on the road, you know, pushing me there about some ethnic, you know, degrees. Another person was also responding to him. Now he said, you are talking as if you are the Almighty. How dull and blind you are. You are talking about many, many years to come. You are so sure here. When you are so stuck. Yeah. That's a dull person who thinks he's right. What you don't know, be careful to talk about it. It's only by faith. You can believe God for it. You can't be too sure. So when you brag a lot, excuse me, you don't really know what you're talking about. Jeremiah 7:9. Will you steal, murder, commit adultery, swear falsely, burn incense to bear, and work after idols which you do not know? Today people follow just anything. Things they don't know. If God they know, they get tired of him. The devils they don't know, they begin to say they want because they want money. They join societies, they join fraternities, just to be among the Joneses. Ecclesiastes 11:5-6. As you do not know, now this is key. You don't know what is the way of the wind. You don't know how the wind goes, where it comes from, or how the bones grow in the womb of the hair which you have. You don't know how wounds form. Even though it's called cartilage at that level, even that cartilage is still like, it's deputy bones. You don't know how they form. From that semen, have you not bothered about that? Just that semen. A sick cartilage being formed, a whole human being, eyes in place, mouth in place, the 2 ears where they should be. How awesome this God is. That we belong to that God is enough for us to be bold every day of our lives and never let things or people intimidate us. That makes your faith very awesome. You don't know the way of the wind, and then how bones go in the womb of a pregnant woman, so you do not know the works of God who makes them. You don't know God's words. How, as we speak, it can make you a commissioner in your state in the next few days. You don't know the works of the Lord. Let's look at our faith to come out of the prison. It's so frozen. What must be your faith? You don't know the way of the wind. You don't know how God is in motion as we speak. How in a gift, in the next 2 minutes, something will just totally change about you. And it's like, how did I get here? we don't know, we are not actually anticipating such things. It's better with because it's written. So don't get stuck on the salary you're collecting, your mother's salary, mother's that income. What you call income is not up to what you come in. What you come in is more than what is coming in. Income is not what you come in. The more concerned about the coming in, the coming in of stock than the income. Amen? Focus more on what you come in and not get hooked up on the income. My income. My annual. Income. Stuff is coming in. From the Lord, things is so you come in from His presence. That was all that came to Solomon's heart. Isn't that part of your income? All that came to his heart. So if his income you are focusing on, what that becomes in? All that came into his heart. Let's just enter into your heart more than the income you are waiting for. You are too big for that thing called income. When things come into your heart, you'll be accessing more than you call income. You are too big for that monthly nonsense. This is designed now, not just you. Okay? Think and have higher thoughts of God. That you are too big to be living by what you call income. Imagine what you are attracting every day. You don't know the works of God. You can just mention to the president's wife, and you won't even wait to mention. Just come in there, in the Lamo Day. You are watching that. And what have I done? You know, he's not going to help us. He's coming and asking. You are living. You are saying amen. You know why? Because you are not sure what God is doing. You are looking at how it has not been working. Look, every single one. And it has only. Hallelujah. So in the morning, sow your seed. In the evening, don't dump your head because you don't know which will prosper. You don't know because you don't. Just keep sowing seed. Keep sowing seed. You don't know how it will have a struggle of God's kingdom. You do not know which will prosper. Whether the one you gave in the morning or yesterday or Sunday, or the one you will give this morning, or both. You do not know. So keep sowing your seed. Every chance you have, sow seed. I know my son said this morning, saying that my rent is due. I'm a little boy. That's not as I made it. Yesterday for two. And I smiled. Meanwhile, what I was gathering to do that talk, this same morning, everything had to go into plant. Can I have an amen there? Just this morning, what should have gone to him went to three other people who were waiting for the answers. And I was holding the answers to my hand. The answers was the moment for my people, the moment for God's people to do. His own company. You don't need to prosper. And okay, let's start to bam! No! The Lord was saying, hey, no, fix this one first. Fix that one. Yes, that one. As I did one, send me a test. Sir, don't forget me. Ah, I said, that's true. I promised to pay. Now, three people this morning. And I said, no, thank you. And the account was in billions. I tried to transfer. My first story will be protected. And so I'm a children. I said, God, for all of them. Do it from the first. When you, let me show you that first. Because when we are doing our planning, you have your goal set. What did you see before you set the goal? Oh. Goal setting is the worst level of blindness. Now, that does not mean you set goals. But I just want to put it to you that when you set goals and you didn't wait to see, the great and manifest God was trying to show you and you have stepped close, you actually are too blind. What you said as good is a reflection of how blind you are. You don't see anything. Pick this up from your environment. So goal setting, even budget, which is an estimate. What is budget? Now, I'm not saying don't set goals. I do too. I don't say don't do budgeting. I do a lot of budgeting. But there are levels of cataract findings. You have levels, God, have your budget, but leave space for God to move into, for the wind to blow stuff into. Can I have an amen there? But if you stick to the budget, you actually get it. You can put it in. Who gave you what you budgeted for? Whose vision did you see before you made the budget? It's not budget based on oil prices. When the case of the money, oil prices dropped. You were afraid of what Iran would do. And nations budget began to say special, because one man was there. This is a budget of hundreds of millions of people based on blindness. On environmental forces. And this is what I want to say, great many things. So you can point it based on that. Hallelujah. Ask if I could have budgeted for my resources based on you, I could never make a budget for them to go there. So if I had my budget, senior conductor. Costain. As Omar could talk, you have been a senior conductor. If not for the business of God I saw, I could not have budgeted for education and grace for Corona. Never. So if I waited for budgeting, I would have killed those boys. And you listen to me. Get me quoted anywhere, I put it to you, set your goals, but let me hear from you how the goals were set. What did God show you before you put your goals together? Like a goal setter. So, is there goals? Of course, they say it should be realistic. You remember, smart. Goes to be smart, compliant. What are S? Specific. M, measurable. A, attainable. R, realistic, then T, time bound. Housekeeping. What time is finding that thing? There is time and there is time of life. So which one is your own key? The time your short-sightedness, your myopia, told you this must happen. Or the time of life. And God said, I shall visit you at the time of life. And you have to say, that is not compliant. You can't pick it up. Not even agenda objects, MBO can help you there. We need stuff. We need the word of God. The deep word. So don't get inundated with stuff that are godless. So when the goals have been met, you know, there is this pride you have. 89% accomplished. Evil encounter. If somebody who didn't say anything, God was showing. And set goals that his ego will be happy to have accomplished. How much of the project we accomplished in 2019? 80% completion. That's minus 50. There is bigger than minus 1. There is a good number. A good number. Then we are minus 50. Can we just come up that thought to call budget? Have the plan. Let God do the plan for you. When you still see what you should see, you will think that I'm planning better. Look at that. I was planning to pay my son's accommodation fee in the Ukraine. And the master of all plans said, my friend, your son is my let's do something. And that will just thank you and me. And in a way, you said, if I have qualification, I want to better my notes. I pay this balance. I just put the wire into what I'm talking about. Do I know which one trust them? I am here. When would the year stop? Let the Lord show you what you don't know. And you will be at your hand every time. On a frequency nobody can understand. To this person, you don't know your grace. As long as they know, you wait to see what he wants to show you. Great and mighty things. Just one thing. Who does not know what you know? All you know, we also know. I'm not inferior to you. It's in the doctor. I'm not inferior to you. I'm not inferior to you. What you know, we also know. But what we don't know, you also don't know. The place of him who does not know God. Those who don't know God have their own place. They have the assembly they belong to. They don't join such assembly. They could be in church, but they don't know God. I have God is going to say, if someone's what is not there, as it is with death for 1,000 years, that's what God will say. But not many in church know him. Not many preachers of God know God. Not many people on TV have to know God. There is a dwelling of those who don't know them. The people that do know their God shall be strong and be exploited. It's a such is the dwelling place of those who don't know God. They preach him, they teach about him, they hear of him, but they don't know him. You would know God a bit and not operate in his own faith. To have the faith of God. Have God's kind of faith. What's that faith? Faith that is so sure of what will happen that you start walking towards it. Looking for our son's past from the UK. Can we pray for them now? They then told us. Appointment that day. But without the car, that good appointment. Send me home. Come on, let's go to the doctor. We were going by faith. Yeah. Without cars, no show, no team. We were going there. When the agent called, where are you? He said, we are almost at. He said, he said, you can't go there without. He said, that's not the issue. The God kind of faith does not wait before it moves. Get our pastor. He said, I would have said, no, we don't wait. We are already almost there. As we are about to enter, the cars came in. They can say, sir, what kind of person are you? It doesn't happen on Saturday. You don't send cars on Saturday. Why is yours different? Because we set out like the lepers say. If we stay here, we die. If we go, we die. What if they don't kill us? Let's set out. And he set out back and God said, I'm ready for this also to die. I will let you die. You were almost empty. You're on the street. Here I go. Yeah, you're on the street. That's it. No. This US embassy. Yeah, we are right on the street. Just by not street. By not street. We're on the street. By faith. Then the class came. Yes, sir. You said, we're almost there. We're on the street now. Say, you don't go there. We said, we know. I said, no, you wait. I said, we can't wait. We are ready here. And the king, he said, sir, if your snapper is happy, just as come as that, your point is special. I said, well, that's the God we are giving you. You don't wait for the enemy. It's yours, the wrong thing. The dwelling place of those who know God, you will not be found in Jesus' name. My friend, don't just watch a program on, because on TV. Most of that cutting of TV is wrong. It's full of unbelief and doubt. You see it on TV too. And there are people that are listening to awesome because of the world. So I'm not here to knock up on TV. No, I'll still appear there. But listen, don't just follow because a big man is preaching. Listen to the content he's talking about. Listen to the content, please. It is not clear before you start quoting or parroting, ask questions. I have this. Is it true? Or check the Bible, ask your pastor. Please! There's a dwelling place of those who don't know them. They are always together in unbelief. They are together, iron, sharpening iron in unbelief. It is happening. They ask for them. Oh, you also. Yep, that's what we are. I'm also there. So we are many. How many? Oh, all of us. We are still jammed before. Four times. Oh, we have attempted several now. Jammed attempted four times. Don't join that kind of. Those who don't know, that's the daily place. Don't stay there. Look for those who say, Kalibu Hadada Bahada. Why are you here? We are special people here. They say, no room. Say, you just apply to us. They will open that gate. It's others have gone here. We are not others. Kalabai Hadada. We are not others. We are not like others. We will not be others. We are special people. Look for that kind of dwelling. That's the desire those who know God have found. Can I have a amen there? Looking at what we don't know. If those who don't know God, they're very precise, those who know Him have the place to dwell too. They're in the arena of faith. Oh, all things are possible for them because we work with God. They tell you right now, accounts are full. You ask them for 5,000, they say, oh, praise the Lord. They will never say they don't have because they always have. How can you not have? I always have. But I'm not holding it right now. I have. You see, account, that's not the issue. It's in the account of God. And I draw from there. I have heavenly bank accounts. I draw from there. When I need something, it comes from the heavenly account. Forget my account, UB or whatever bank. When I need stuff, it comes from heavenly account. So I'm rich towards God. Am I preaching or teaching this way? All of the above. Am I evangelizing? I mean, really. You know, this word is true. Let's stop this Christianity, this modernizing. The word of God is true. Let's believe the word. There's nothing else to do. You're taking it out. There's no time to preach anyway. Get the word. Walk with the word. Hallelujah. Look at this. Psalm 39, verse 6. Psalm 39, 6. 39, 6. Yeah, please read. Show every man. Walks about like a shadow. Surely they busy themselves in vain. He heaps up riches. Read on, please. And does not know who will gather them. He heaps up riches. Forbes would say, this is his worth. Forbes, the assessor, and the assessed. None of them will know who will gather the riches. The wealth of the sinner is being stockpiled for the just. that gathered stuff will still be used up by those who beat the poor. That's the Bible. So what are you getting? You are saving. Thank God for the savings, but God does not save you. Not because of the savings. Get the savings, and I'm okay with the savings. But you just need the safety of the Lord for God to give you a safety before you can use your savings. People were left Tehran in the night, going to somewhere. All savings gone. Nothing could save them. What has happened to their savings? And they are saying it was human error. Caused by U.S. adventure. That's how life is so intangible that you, the only thing that speaks for you is the stuff you have in heaven. Lay up prayers for yourself in heaven where there's no breakthrough by the arrow. But I tell you people, Christians don't need a breakthrough. I'm not going to sleep. Matthew 6 tells me now. If you're looking at a breakthrough, not in GMC. Jesus never broke through. There was no chance of breakthrough. He didn't need it. Why? Iron gate open unto him. And if I fumble, what are we preaching? 7 steps to having breakthrough. No, I will never break through. To break means to have so much success. So much energy, bah, you break through. No, when you follow the Holy Ghost, no breakthrough is required. Jesus will melt, opposition disappears. When you see some industry, this mountain, you gotta move all mountain. You gotta move, I speak right now in the name of Jesus. I make up my mind, I'm going through your mountain. You got to move. Almost pooping because monkey has to move. It takes just simple faith. But you are starting. You got to move home. No dramatizing. He says, if you are faith as tiny as a mustard seed, you will say to monkey, be moved. No discussion. No resistance. Or have you concluded that? You just know who will use the riches. Yes, no, no. Young man is expecting his mission to be paid. I'm not the one to pay the Lord. Okay? And then I said, let's go this way because in the morning, so you see it. In the evening, so it's 2 a.m. So because we don't leave all the pastor unknown, at least one would. They are planning for your wife and your family. So I will not be worse than an infidel. One scripture will not save you. You should compare scripture with scripture. And above all, here. The voice of the Lord. That's the proceeding word. Amen. Praise the Lord. Somebody's changed. Is he here? Are you here? Ask the neighbor, are you still here? Ask your partner, Kevin. No. Hallelujah. Mark 4:26. Mark 4. The things we don't know, the God we don't know. And he said, the kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground. Next. And should sleep by night and rise by day, and the seed should sprout and grow. He himself does not know how. He doesn't know how. He's done his planting. He's gone to bed to sleep. He says, the sprouting of the seed is not for you to start tracking and monitoring. It does not know how. The tithes you paid, the offering you gave, you don't know how these things are working. But don't say, whatever you give, you forget it. That's stupid. No farmer does some planting and forgets it. The most much is not much by way of the beginning. How can you plant so much and you forgot what you planted? That's the holiness. That's dumbness. That's witchcraft. You don't know how. That means it will start and grow. It's not for you to know. You cannot know how. You don't know how it grows or sprouts. Just believe something's happening. you don't just word, it will bring forth fruit and harvest. Amen. It gives bread to the eater, seed to the sower. Hallelujah. That's the goal with some. Say amen there. Our God is good, amen. For you, Lord, have made me glad through your word. Not many can quote this because they are always studying the Satan's words. It's always Satan, Satan, devil. This person was gladdened by the works of the Lord. Are you studying the Satan's works? He said, I will triumph in the works of your hands. Quickly. Oh Lord, how great are your words. Your thoughts are very good. Look at next one. The wicked, the evil man, the gangster. A sense them does not know, nor does a fool understand this. That your thoughts are very good. That's why you get great things done. How shallow or deep are your thoughts? Even on an issue. If God has to think and engage in deep thoughts before he can do one work, and the work becomes so great and it makes people happy, why shouldn't you be like that? Why should you be sharing your thoughts about a matter? It's not even to pray, just to take it up and think through it. I'm not talking of thinking as a natural person, thinking as a spiritual person. Letting the Holy Ghost into your thoughts. That was when Peter was considering the vision of unclean stuff. It's not in God's name, no, I've cleaned it. Don't say it's unclean. While he was thinking, while he was engrossed in that thought, Holy Ghost came into his thoughts. So I'm talking of thoughts that you let Holy Ghost into. Not thoughts filled with your unbelief and strife and bitterness and jaundiced judgment. Holy Ghost wants to come into your thoughts. And love when it comes into your thoughts. You're thinking. Yes, I will go to bed and have a good night. As you come back 2 hours after, I will sleep. I see you this man. You have not slept. Since I've been sleeping, that I got. Since I've been sleeping. And so much, I'm a hunter. So much to catch from the scriptures. I have so many traps I've put everywhere. What is the reality? The wisdom said, whatever you may have lost in life, spiritual power will make you recover it. Spiritual power will make you recover all you've lost. Spiritual power will make you recover everything you have lost. So what I'm talking about? Where is your power? In the word. Otherwise, you'll be taken to be by wife, the man person. And he will wash your body and you. And offer you. Hallelujah. I don't know why they're always going to the body of people to wash. If they were real, why would that be the place of ministry? Look at John 3. Okay, no, sir. Proverbs 9. Yes, I don't want to skip it. 9:13 Proverbs. 9:13 Proverbs. That woman, the Lord bless you. I wanted to skip it, I won't say I'm anti-woman, but it is written. A foolish woman is clamorous. That means she clamors for everything. She's rambunctious. She's cantankerous. She's clamorous. She's simple. Simple does not mean quiet. It's just that dull and knows nothing. Kill her. Tell somebody you don't know anything. No person can kill you there or kill himself there. Just she knows nothing. That's why she's clamorous. So simple or brilliant and vague. It can happen to men too. It's both ways. So quit this angle. A foolish woman is, or man is clamorous, always going to raise an issue out of nothing. Always wanting to have her way, or his way, rather. showing what he or she knows nothing. But why is this person clamorous? Why is he so, you know, because you think you know, that's why you are like, let's be this way. No, it cannot be like that. No, you can't correct me. No, I know what I'm doing. Because you think you know what you are doing. But you know nothing. So you know not what you should know. That's why you are clamorous. A man of, or woman of understanding or knowledge will always humbly learn from other people. If you hit him, criticize him, he's happy with it because he wants to learn more. He does not see as an enemy because he sees as a friend who wants things to get better with him. That's why you are criticizing of and critical of him. So that's why he's a man of understanding, a woman of knowledge. But one who thinks he knows or she knows, and everything, every correction is rebuffed, is rejected, everyone is an enemy who criticizes him or her, he says, she will be or he will be clamorous, an attention-seeking person. So simple, plain, vague, and bland, showing that he knows or he knows nothing. We are looking at what we don't know. This person does not know anything. The Bible tells me so. There's some quite some young now. That's why I wanted to skip it. But it's in the Bible. Hallelujah. Women, are you still in the house? Men, are you still here? Look at John 3:10. Jesus asked a question. He asked Nicodemus a very profound question. John 3. Let me, when you talk about being born again, from verse 1, and Nicodemus asked, he said, will a man enter the mother's womb again? He said, no. Now, at the end of it all, he answered the man, Nicodemus, are you the teacher of Israel and do not know these things? So a teacher may not even know what he's talking. Here was the teacher of Israel. So he said, how have you been teaching them without knowing these things? And to a teacher, and to a counselor, and to leading people, how is it you don't know these things? How? Think about it. We all have people who teach stuff. Parents teach their children. I think they know everything. Even children teach themselves. Teach their younger siblings. Everybody's a teacher somewhere, some line, no? At some point. We all are teachers. But you know that you can never teach above what you know. And if what you know is already outdated, there's a problem with you and with those you teach. You'll be teaching only what you think you know, but what you know has become obsolete. It's archaic. It's no longer relevant, and you're still teaching. The Lord bless those you are teaching. Jesus asked him, "You are a teacher of Israel. A teacher. How don't you know these things? I can't comprehend that." All right. I still want to give you one or two. Let me take 5 minutes of your time or 10 minutes, okay? 11 can I leave you. I'll let you go. Okay, John 13:7. John 13:7. Hallelujah. John 13:7. Still of my master Jesus Christ. Jesus answered and said to him, what I am doing you do not understand now. Give me King James here. But you will know after this. What I am saying or doing right now, thou knowest not. But thou shalt know hereafter. I will stop here when I will explain this. This was Jesus, and he's alive today, amen, by the Holy Ghost. This what I am doing, you do not know. But you will get to know after this time out. How does that touch me and to you? What he is doing in your life, you don't know. Help me tell somebody very close to you, and can put it to you, you do not know what the Lord is doing about you, about the matter. I don't know. I don't know. Because you don't know now. You don't know. No matter what you know. You don't know what I am doing. Oh my God. You only know what I have done. Which I have done. It's past. That's what you call it, testimony. It's what I'm doing, you don't know. And Sunday we'll be talking, thanking God for, among other things, the things God has done, God is doing, God will do, and thanking God for who God is. But there's somebody who says, I don't know anything about what was doing in your life. You don't know. I don't know. I've been in many things. If I knew, I wouldn't be like this. Pardon me. Oh, somebody knows what God is doing right now. Uncle D. I know you know so much. Hallelujah. You're a consultant. Just said, what I am doing, that is not you. Just be encouraged. Later, you'll get to know. Tell somebody, you'll find out later. About 4 or 5 days ago, I was given information, and as I was got the information, I knew where the matter would end. But I was just careful. I was calm. I had to be careful. I said, how can this happen? Please don't. The man I prayed, the man I got the witness, this is going to happen. Hey. And eventually it happened. Last night, I was supposed to call somebody. I called late in the night. Pam! Hello, how are you? Pam, what's the update? And he said, that. And he said, this and that. My wife was there. So, I had to pray a religious prayer, which I knew would not work. Papa Hagen, I just let me say it. There are times in his life he was to pray over people or things. As he was about to pray, God would tell him, don't pray, that person will die. How can you tell me not to pray? That's how I want to pray. He said, no, you pray about what you are not supposed to have. I am telling you the outcome. So it does not respond to what you pray. I have only told you what it will be. So you are only honored to know. So to now think I pray about it, you are just more wise. I could listen to you intercede for people, fine. But I have only this one in my perfect will has to die. So the father has to, that's why you are now praying. Okay. He said, was he trying to pray? He goes, I have just told you, pray over other things. You don't know my pleasure about this matter. I have just told my pleasure. It's not subject to emotional outburst. A lot of times I've gone through that thing, even up to last night. So, well, thank you, Jesus. All right, so what am I saying? There are things we don't know. So when God now shows you because of the honor he has for you, it's not something you want. If it was open to intercession, fine. God could let you intercede and he will listen. Yeah, that's the level for that, the level of that. But when he tells you, this is a close chapter. This person, look at the service you had, was he telling that also? Which one now? They can judge. Okay, crossover. That was not to be played about. No discussion. Until that, I was not so sure. But when I was there, I said, you are not going anywhere. Anywhere to bring your dad, and you are the first son. But you are not going there. The will of God is made clear. So that is
to show that you are a child of God. When God reveals to you, that's the final authority. No negotiations, no emotional affiliations. That's why we have to grow to that level where we don't pray some religious foolish prayer in the name of his praying. I must not pray. No! You have to grow to a point where you know this can be prayed about. Because God revealed to me. The man of God said, it was revealed to me last night that there will be a loss, but not loss of life, only this trip will have a problem. Hi! That was not what I could pray to stop. Something must get lost. It was not any life. Tell somebody, go to that level. Where it is not as they thought, to, in the name of Jesus, ask first, is this worth praying about? He says, yes, then, cling to it. He says, no, don't worry yourself. It's sorted out. Then leave it. As we're up for these few days, I will just come. I was just like indifferent because I knew the result of the matter. But I bless God for his faithfulness. Hallelujah. Let us pray this morning. Let's pray. The things you don't know, get to find out before you pray or believe God for something. Don't just pray, waste prayer on what you are believing God for. It's higher when you know what is. You say, what I do now, you don't know. But you know, listen. Pray this morning, Lord, the things I don't know, show me. Just call unto me, I will answer you. And I will show you great and mighty things you do not know. Pray, Lord, show me those things I do not know. Take me to the level where I get to know what I should know, that I may approach things in life in a different manner. Not in the usual religious way. In the name of Jesus. And with that, I'm done.